Good morning, my dear friends. Today we are going to talk about dominant eigenvalues and applications. This is not a topic which you encounter in your traditional linear algebra course because it is on the boundary of numerical linear algebra, ecological biology, mathematical modeling, numerical methods, and many other fields. What are eigenvalues? Eigenvalues of a matrix are of considerable theoretical interest and wide-ranging applications. What is an eigenvalue? If you have a n cross n matrix A, lambda is said to be an eigenvalue if there exists a non-zero vector x such that Ax equal to lambda x. Then we say that lambda is an eigenvalue and x is the corresponding eigenvector. Please look into your PPT. The eigenvalue problem plays a critical role in solving systems of linear equations, in finding large powers of matrices, and analyzing population models. The very word eigenvalue, it is a hybrid of German and English. It derives from the German word Eigenwert, introduced by Hilbert in 1904. Eigenvalues occur in widely varied situations and have been called by different names. If you want to really look into you should read the finite dimensional vector spaces by P.R. Helmholtz, in which he writes, almost every combination of the objectives, proper, latent, characteristic, eigen and secular, with nouns root, number and value, has been used in the literature for what we call a proper value. He tried to introduce the proper English word proper value, but people did not take to it, so we stick with the nomenclature eigenvalue. Lambda belonging to R is said to be an eigenvalue if there is a non-zero vector x such that Ax equal to lambda times x. X is said to be an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. How do you find the eigenvalues of a matrix? Let us start with an n cross n matrix A. Lambda is an eigenvalue if and only if A minus lambda I x equal to theta has a non-trivial solution. This is possible if and only if determinant A minus lambda I equal to 0. For this reason, determinant A minus lambda I, which is a monic polynomial of degree n in lambda, is called the characteristic polynomial of A, and we denote it by the symbol chi A lambda. Chi A lambda is called the characteristic polynomial of A. Therefore, lambda is an eigenvalue if and only if lambda is a root of the equation. Let us for simplicity call it as P lambda. P lambda, which is same as chi A lambda, and lambda is a eigenvalue of A if and only if lambda is a root of the equation P lambda equal to 0. You know that generally given an equation, it may not have a real root. So a matrix may not have any real eigenvalues. However, because of the fundamental theorem of algebra, P lambda equal to 0 always has a complex root. So every matrix has a complex eigenvalue and the corresponding eigenvector. Supposing lambda is a root and lambda is a root and its multiplicity is 3, we say that the eigenvalue lambda has algebraic multiplicity 3. With every eigenvalue, we associate the two terms algebraic multiplicity and geometric multiplicity. What is algebraic multiplicity? It tells you how many times lambda is a root of the characteristic polynomial. What is geometric multiplicity? Geometric multiplicity is the dimension of null space of A minus lambda I. It is well known that the geometric multiplicity is always less than or equal to the algebraic multiplicity. Please look into the PPT. how to find the eigenspace corresponding to an eigenvalue lambda. We want to solve the equation A minus lambda I x equal to theta. This is a homogeneous system of linear equations, and the solution set of this gives the corresponding eigenvalue and the eigenvector corresponding to lambda. Please look into the PPT. A matrix A is said to be diagonalizable if there exists an invertible matrix P such that P inverse AP is a diagonal matrix. You know what a diagonal matrix is. A diagonal matrix is one in which the diagonal elements are non-zero. All other elements above and below the diagonal are zero. Here is an example of a diagonalizable matrix. If A is the matrix 1, 3, look into the PPT. A is 1, 3, 2, 2 and P is 1, minus 3, 1, 2. We find that P inverse AP is the diagonal matrix. These two theorems play a vital role in the diagonalizability of matrices. A matrix A is diagonalizable if and only if it has n linearly independent eigenvectors. Why? If it has n linearly independent eigenvectors, say x1, x2, etc., xn, then we can write Ax1 equal to lambda 1 x1, Ax2 equal to lambda 2 x2, and so on. Lastly, Axn equal to lambda n xn. Since x1, x2, etc., xn are linearly independent, they form a basis for Rn, and with respect to the basis, the matrix of A is the diagonal matrix lambda 1 0 0 0 0 lambda 2 0 0 lastly 0 0 lambda n. Therefore, the matrix is diagonalizable. Next theorem says eigenvectors corresponding to distinct eigenvalues are linearly independent. We have already used it in theorem 1. Iterative methods for computing eigenvalues. Why do we need iterative methods for computing eigenvalues? Normally, we find eigenvalues by solving the characteristic equation of the matrix. But there are certain factors which make this method impractical for large examples. Firstly, the method depends on computation of a determinant, which is very time consuming. And secondly, there is no known method for solving polynomial equations of degree higher than 4. In such cases, iterative methods are very useful. In this case, after approximating an eigenvector, the corresponding eigenvalue can be found. What we are doing here, we are reversing the process. Normally, we find an eigenvalue and then find the corresponding eigenvector by solving the system of homogeneous linear equations. But now we are going to reverse the process. We are going to approximate an eigenvector by numerical techniques and then find the corresponding eigenvalue. For many matrices, especially that arise in a biological context, there is a single dominant eigenvalue, that is eigenvalue with the largest magnitude. For example, if 1, minus 2 and 3 are the eigenvalues of a 3 by 3 matrix, then 3 is the eigenvalue with the largest magnitude. 3 is the dominant eigenvalue here. After a long period of time, the population structure becomes proportional to the dominant eigenvector. For this reason, dominant eigenvalue is often called the intrinsic growth rate of the population. Now, I will show you the power method for finding the dominant eigenvector. This power method is something very similar to what you have studied in numerical analysis, method of fixed point iteration, Newton-Raphson method. All these are iterative methods. You start with an initial value and keep on repeating a certain procedure, and finally it lands you the root. This is precisely similar method is what we are going to use here. In this method, we just directly utilize the system matrix, and therefore we do not have to evaluate the characteristic polynomial or its roots. Let us take an example and work it out. But before we work out an example, let us see why this method works. Okay, what is the theorem? Please see the theorem. A is an n diagonalizable matrix with a dominant eigenvalue lambda 1. Then there exists a non-zero vector x0 such that the sequence of vectors xk defined by x1 equal to ax0, x2 equal to ax1, in general xk plus 1 equal to axk approaches a multiple of a dominant eigenvector of A. In principle, what the theorem says, suppose A is a diagonalizable matrix which has a dominant eigenvector, we can find eigenvalue and corresponding eigenvector. We can approximate it like this. Start with some vector x0, keep on applying A to it. At some stage that the sequence approaches the dominant eigenvector of A. Why does this work? Let us see why this formula works. Since A is diagonalizable, it has n linearly independent eigenvectors x1, x2, etc., xn with corresponding eigenvalues lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda n. Lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda n, they may not all be distinct. Some of them may be of algebraic multiplicity R. If the geometric multiplicity is equal to R, then we have no problem. A will still be diagonalizable. Suppose that the eigenvalues are ordered lambda 1 greater than lambda 2 greater than or equal to lambda 3, etc. So lambda 1 is the dominant eigenvalue. Now since x1, x2, x3 are linearly independent, they form a basis for Rn. So any vector in Rn can be expressed as a linear combination of these basis vectors. For an initial guess, let us choose a non-zero vector x0 and let us express that as a linear combination of the basis vectors x1, x2, etc., xn. Let x0 be c1, x1 plus c2, x2 plus etc., cn, xn. We will assume that c1 is not equal to 0. We can always choose a vector x0 such that c1 is not equal to 0. Let us apply A to both sides. So we have Ax0 equal to A of C1 X1 plus C2 X2 up to Cn Xn. Remember, every matrix is a linear transformation. So we can write this as C1 Ax1 plus C2 Ax2 plus etc. Cn Axn. Now eigenvalues are lambda 1, lambda 2, etc., lambda n. So this is c1 lambda 1 x1 plus c2 lambda 2 x2, etc., cn lambda n xn. Now let us calculate a squared x0. It will be very similar. A again applied to x1 will give us lambda 1 x1. So it becomes c1 lambda 1 squared x1, c2 lambda 2 squared x2, etc., cn lambda n squared xn. Proceeding like this, at the kth stage, we obtain a raised to k of x0 equal to c1, lambda 1 raised to k x1, c2 lambda 2 raised to k x2, and lastly cn lambda n raised to k xn. Let us divide both sides by lambda 1 raised to k. So a raised to k at x0 divided by lambda 1 raised to k will give us c1 x1 plus c2 into lambda 2 by lambda 1 raised to k x2, etc., cn lambda n by lambda 1 raised to k xn. Now since lambda 2 by lambda 1 modulus of this is less than 1, as k tends to infinity, lambda 2 by lambda 1 raised to k tends to 0. Therefore, as k tends to infinity, a raised to k x0 by lambda 1 raised to k approximately equals c1 x1. This approximation improves as k increases. Now, x1 is a dominant eigenvector. any scalar multiple of that is also a dominant eigenvector. Therefore, what we have proved is A raised to k x naught approaches a multiple of the dominant eigenvector of A. Let us illustrate that. First of all, let us see, once we know the dominant eigenvector, how do we find the corresponding eigenvalue? This method is known as, please look into your PPT, this is known as the Rayleigh coefficient method. If x is an eigenvector of a matrix A, then its corresponding eigenvalue is given by lambda equal to inner product Ax dot x divided by inner product x dot x. This quotient is called the Rayleigh quotient, because numerator is lambda times x dot x, that will give you lambda into inner product xx. Denominator is inner product xx. Since x is not equal to 0, by axiom of inner product xx is not equal to 0. So we get lambda equal to ax dot x divided by x dot x. Normally, but what happens in actual practice is, when you keep on iterating, xk's can get very large and this may cause significant round off errors. To reduce the errors, we shall use the method of scaling, in which xk is divided by the component with maximum absolute value. Let us see this in an example. I will start with the exact. Let us start with the matrix A equal to 1, 1, 2, 0. As a first approximation, I will take x naught equal to 1, 0. Now,